Welcome to the second half of the day. I have the pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Ruslan Salahkhudino. Doesn't really need an introduction. I think if you have been kind of following broad deep learning, machine learning community, he has been extremely active in that. Over past few years, I think he has been shuttling around between Canada and US. So, graduated from U of Toronto, then he was with MIT for a couple of years. I think he changed his mind, went back to Toronto, took up a position over there. But then he realized, you know, this is sort of a better place. So, came here. He's a professor with CMU as well as he's a director of AI with Apple here. I do not want to kind of enumerate all of the awards and recognitions that he has had, but you can get an idea. He has over 100 odd publications now with in excess of like, what, 25,000 odd citations. So that speaks for itself in terms of the impact that his work has been having. And we have been extremely fortunate to have Ruslan. So I'll just let him take over.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me. And also, I'd like to thank the organizers for putting this thing together. What I'd like to do today is I'd like to talk about a research, something that we call the neural map, which is a structured map for deep reinforcement learning. Parts of the talk is going to be a little bit technical, so I apologize for that, but I'll try to give you a high level of ideas of why do we believe memory is going to be important for reinforcement learning agents. So I'm going to give you a little bit of a background on RL, just so that we are all on the same page. Then most of the talk I'll spend talking about neural map, which is location-aware memory. I'll finish off with a couple of examples of what we call pose estimation using attention-based recurrent neural networks. And also I'm going to show you how can we incorporate prior knowledge using memory, in particular prior linguistic knowledge with memory. So let me start by saying that probably many of you have heard about supervised learning, right? So most of the deep learning algorithms are posed as a supervised learning problem, right? You're basically mapping inputs to the outputs, and you're typically making assumption that the environment is static. It doesn't change over time. And you're also typically making assumption that the data is IID, but more importantly, that the outputs are independent of each other. So for example, labeling one image doesn't really, you know, impact you labeling another image. But environments in reinforcement learning are typically dynamic. They can change over time. So if you want to build an autonomous agent, you have to be able to handle new environments over time, right? The dynamic environments. Actions can also affect the environment with arbitrary time lags. So one example is that, you know, you can buy stock today, but you can lose all the money in the future, long time into the future, right? So your actions can impact the future. And I'll get to that problem, specific problem in this talk. Most importantly, labels can be expensive or difficult to get. For example, imagine you're trying to find the optimal actuations of a swimming octopus, right? How do you get labels for that? And reinforcement learning is one particular framework for dealing with these problems. So here, instead of providing a label, the agent is actually given a reward signal. And the idea is that high rewards basically correspond to good behaviors. So the way that reinforcement learning is set up is that you have an agent, the agent takes an action, the environment gives you back the next state, and sometimes the environment also gives you a reward. Basically, it's telling you, was that action good or bad? And typically, your rewards are typically fairly sparse. And in the context of reinforcement learning, it's all about learning behaviors in dynamic environments. You're essentially trying to map observations to actions. And the hope is that you're going to be maximizing long-term reward. Now, in the context of deep reinforcement learning, that's a term that kind of probably many of you have heard in the last few years. What essentially deep reinforcement learning is you're essentially using a deep network to parameterize your policy, right? And your policy is really taking observation and producing the action. And now with deep learning, you know, your observation space can be very complex. It could be an image, it could be some other signal, or I'll show you some examples of combining language and images in order to produce this policy. And you're essentially adapting parameters by to maximize your reward using, there's a whole bunch of different algorithms. And I should also point out that reinforcement learning as a sort of a subfield in machine learning existed for a very long time. So this is not sort of new, right? It's been around for almost 30 or 40 years. Let me show you actually one particular example of what these deep reinforcement learning agents can do. I'm going to show you an example that was developed by Chaplot and Lample. It was published in AAAI, but it kind of illustrates what it can be done. So both of them, I believe, were at CMU, and actually Lample right now is at Facebook, I believe. But here's what they've done. So what you're going to see here is you're going to see an environment which is Doom-like environment, and you're trying to get your agent to just navigate in this environment. So the goal is to train the agent to move around in the environment. The input to the system are the frames, what you're seeing on the screen, and the output is the action, you know, turn left, turn right, and such. And the reward structure is just collect as many objects as possible, right? So the interesting thing about this system is that you're not really telling the agent how to navigate. You're really telling the agent just collect as many objects as possible. And through this process of Q learning or deep Q learning and actor-critic type of systems, the model is actually able to navigate in these complex environments. They're fairly simplistic, and then you can, you know, train it with random actions. There is sort of APIs that people have built. But what's remarkable is that once you train these systems, you can also place them in completely new environment, the environment that you've never seen before, and these agents can still navigate this in these environments without any problems. So here is a setting where you just throw an agent in an unknown map, and it sort of moves around in the environment, and it has no problems collecting objects. Now, what's missing so far with a lot of existing algorithms is that most of the deep reinforcement learning agents are reactive, right? You see the input, you take the action. And in the last few years, there's been really interesting work of trying to design an external memory mechanism. And there's been wonderful work coming out of Alex Graves at DeepMind. This is neural Turing machine and differentiable neural computers. That essentially designing these external memory modules. And there are something, there are operators that called write and read that allow you to learn what to write in the memory as well as what to read from the memory. But one of the big challenges with existing systems is that these memory systems are very difficult to train, especially when you're using reinforcement learning objectives. Right, and people are actually pretty good. I'm going to show you some examples where people are pretty good at remembering important information about the past. But really, the goal here is: can you remember something in the past so that you can take optimal actions in the future? That's the goal. Let me show you why memory is challenging, and I'm going to show you in a very simple example. Suppose you have an agent in a simple random maze. The agent starts at the top of the maze, and then the agent observes an indicator. And the color of the indicator determines what the correct goal is. So for example, if the indicator is green, you have to find the red target. If the indicator is blue, you have to find a cyan target. So depending on what the indicator is, you have to find a different target. Now that seems like a very easy problem, right? If I told the agent a priori, if you see this, then go there, then the problem would be easy. But now imagine that at the start, there is no prior knowledge that you give to the agent, that there is something that's called indicator, there is something that's called target. By virtue of learning, the agent has to, you know, figure out that there is something that's called indicator, and the color of that indicator is really important. Another interesting point here is that sometimes the time that you have to travel between when you see the indicator versus finding the right goal can be arbitrarily large. And this is a very known problem in machine learning known as long-term problems, because you have to remember for a long period of time the state of the indicator. And so in order to achieve this, the following must hold, right? You have to write the color at the start of the maze, so you have to remember it. You never overwrite the memory of the color over the next t time steps, and you have to find and find the right goal. Right? So it's almost like discovering these causal rules. If you see this, then do that, without actually us telling the agent that these rules exist. One solution is to write everything in the memory. Right? If you can remember your entire life, then you can just find these correlations in the past and then take actions in the future. In fact, there's been a lot of interesting work, something that's called memory networks, was done by Jason Weston at Facebook and then followed up by a few other folks. And the idea here is very simple. You're basically storing the key value representation of the previous M frames, and M is some number that you decide a priori. And then at each time step, you're essentially solving the retrieval problem. You're finding, you know, what in the past correlates with your future. And then you're essentially just writing the latest observation or the latest percept into memory. And these systems have been very popular in question answering, dialogue-based systems and such. But obviously, it's very easy to learn. You just basically remember as much as possible. But it can be inefficient. If we need, for example, you know, store very long time steps, and it's longer than the horizon for you to accomplish the task, you might not know how long, you know, what you need to store. And more importantly, you will be storing a lot of useless and redundant information, right? That's the current approach. And obviously time and space requirements will increase with what you need to store. So the real question is, can you build a system that can learn to store important information and basically disregard useless information? So that brings us to one particular model, which is what we call neural map, which is location aware memory. So here we're introducing one very simple trick. It's actually a fairly trivial trick, but works surprisingly well for different tasks that we've tried. What we're going to do is we're going to create writable memory with a specific inductive bias. We're going to structure our memory into W by W grids, so we define what that grid is. And each location in this grid is going to contain k-dimensional cells. And for every position of our agent, we're going to be writing to this corresponding position x prime, y prime in our memory. Now, we've made a couple of assumptions. One very strong assumption is that, you know, here we're going to be assuming that we know the position of the agent. So for example, if that's where the agent starts, we're going to write into memory what the agent is seeing currently. When the agent is in a different location, we're going to be writing at a different location. When the agent is in a new location, we're going to be writing in a different location. So here's our inductive bias. So in this case, this map acts the agent basically fills the map as it explores the environment, right? Again, the assumption that we know the position of the agent is a pretty strong assumption. And later on, I'm going to tell you how can we kind of avoid this assumption. But for now, let's make an assumption that we have almost perfect GPS coordinates of where the agent is, okay? This also gives us sparse write operations because we know where to write. A lot of previous algorithms, when we look at something called write operation, it's distributed write. So kind of write a little bit everywhere in order to make it differentiable. And in this case, this inductive bias prevents the agent from just basically overwriting its memory fairly frequently. Now, in terms of, you know, overall high-level representation of what this model is doing, it sort of operates as such. Given some state, whatever your observation is, could be a frame in the image, you create features, what you're going to write into the memory, and then you write into the memory at a particular location. And then you take an action. At the next time step, you perform the read operation using attention mechanism. I'm going to explain what that is. And then I'm going to update my memory, and then I take an action. In the environment that I've shown you, the agent just moving around, and then you proceed through multiple time steps, in the environment where I've shown you the agent moving around in Doom-like environment, basically, you can if you've ignored this memory structure, that would be what I've shown you a standard deep reinforcement learning agent would do. There's been a few papers there where people basically said, well, we're also going to have an LSTM-like system, long-term, short-term memory, and so forth. The problem with a lot of these systems is that it's very hard for them to remember very long histories. So here we're trying to design an architecture that we can explicitly write and learn what to write, and then we explicitly read, and we're learning what to read from the memory. Maybe just going through a couple of equations. So I wanted to give you high-level ideas of what these operations are. And at the high level, all these operations are differentiable. So what that means is that we can learn these policies, and we can learn the memories, and we can learn what to write and what to read from the memories in differentiable way, which basically means that we can optimize for our reward, or we can optimize the behavior of our agents. So there are two read operations. There is a global summary operation, which basically looks at the content of the entire memory, comes up with some representation. And there is a context-based retrieval, which is more like given a query, you're trying to retrieve just the parts of the memory. There is a sparse write. You're just basically writing at the agent's position. And then given both the read operation, which is the summary of your memory, and the write operation, which is what you're seeing so far, what you want to store in your memory, based on that, you're computing policy, right? And the policy is, what's the next action I should be taking? Should I be turning left? Should I be turning right? Just a little bit of high level of what these different operations are. The global read operations is basically a simple convolutional neural net, which essentially just, we're passing it through multiple convolutional layers, and we get some global context, some representation of our overall map. And obviously, the parameters of this entire convolutional net are learned. There is also reading operation using attention. And this is, again, this is the work that was pioneered by Bach-Danau in Yoshio Benjo's group for machine translation. Let me show you what this operation does. Let's say that we have only 2x2 memory, and we have a query, which query vector q, which is basically we get from the current state, our current observation, as well as the read, the context, the representation of our read vector, right? Just the global summary of the map. What we can do is we can take a dot product between every single location in the memory and this query vector. So we create these similarity scores, alphas. We normalize them so that they sum up to one. And then you're essentially doing element-wise product between the query similarities and the memory cells. After that, you sum over all positions to obtain your overall context vector. So what's the intuition behind all of these operations? The real intuition is that what you're doing is you want to retrieve a vector, c sub t at time t, in your memory that's closest to your query vector. And later on, we'll see that, that precisely this operation allows us to retrieve from the memory the color of the indicator. Now, why am I doing all of these operations? The reason why I'm doing all of these operations is because the entire scheme here is differentiable. And this is something that's called attention mechanisms. At the high level, the drawback of these read operations is, sometimes these are called soft read operations, is because you have to touch every single location in your memory in order to find, you know, the closest image. And that creates, typically computational becomes very expensive, particularly if your memories become very large. So there's a lot of work on designing something that's called hard attention, where you're just choosing to look at one location, or maybe just a few locations. And you can also train the system using reinforcement learning, but it becomes fairly complicated. So these kinds of operations, again, a lot of it is done to make the whole system be differentiable. Now, when we write into memory, we just create a new k-dimensional vector, and we update the neural map based on the current position, right? So we keep all the cells in the memory, and then we get the new representation of the memory, which is what we're observing right now in the environment, and then we just update that particular part in the memory. So it's a very sparse operation, right? It's using our inductive bias. There is also a way of introducing gating, and that becomes actually very important for us, because the gating here, what it can do is it can basically tell us how much we want to write into the memory. In many cases, if the gating is close to zero, you're basically saying don't write into your memory, which is important because you don't want to write useless information back into the memory. So the model is essentially adapting to learn what does it need to write and how much of it needs to write. And now you basically, to produce a policy, you use those feature vectors to compute the policy of read, write, and your memory. So all of these operations are differentiable. We can take the gradients, we can update parameters of the model. Now, let me just give you an illustration of what this model can do. Here is an environment that we're looking at, And this is the input state, in which is partially observable, right? This is what your agent sees. Your agent doesn't see the full map. Your agent only sees a little part of the environment, right? As if you're navigating. And results are also pretty robust with respect to small noise in your position. So if your position is not quite precise, it doesn't hurt the performance that much. So let me show you an illustration of what the model can do. This is a random maze. You're navigating in the environment, and this is a random maze. The model has never seen this environment before. Now it's a blue environment, so it has to go to the green target. So first it finds the wrong target, backtracks, and navigates in the environment up until it finds the right target. So in this particular situation, the model was could successfully learn that that it needed to store this information, and when it comes down and finds the right target, it basically, from the memory, reads the correct representation, the correct color, right? And again, for us as humans, it's actually very easy. For machines, it's extremely difficult, right? Because we don't really put any prior knowledge into this agent. We basically say, the way you can think about this learning happens is that you throw the agent in the environment. The agent wanders around, stumbles across red block, and gets some positive reward. You say, well, that's great. Next time, I'm going to go to the red block. Next time you hit the red block, you get negative reward. Now you're saying, what's going on? And then through exploration, you start observing that this indicator piece that pops up in the environment is really telling you what is the right target to go to, right? And so you have to externally remember it. This is just some results, and one thing, it doesn't really matter what the numbers are. What's important is that when we look at sort of environments, which is 15 by 15 sort of mazes, we can hit pretty high rate. But what's important is that if you look at models based on LSTMs, which is what people are using right now, you can only hit, 47% or maybe 50% accuracy. Right? So half of the time you can't solve the task. Here is a setting of, the 3D environment, and we can do quite well as well. Now, in the last 5 minutes, what I would like to point out that, obviously there's a problem with neural map, as it requires finding the mapping. One thing we can do is we can use an egocentric map, right? So the agent always writes to the center of the map, and then the agent moves, the entire map moves around, right? So there's a way to get around that. But when we looked at this thing, we basically started thinking about, well, can we actually build a system that can localize? And can we actually build a system in an end-to-end for solving SLAM, which is simultaneous localization and mapping? And this is something one of the works that interns here at Apple were doing. There is something called local estimation, global pose optimization, and really, if you look at these environments, how do you localize in these environments? Which is pretty challenging. And the overall structure is that the way at the high level you can think is whenever you're seeing a few frames, there's something that's called local pose estimation. Then you're aggregating this information, and there's something that's called neural graph optimizer that's trying to find the correct estimation of your pose so that we can localize appropriately. And just to show you that, we've also been trying to look at these more realistic environments. Just to show you, this is an environment coming from Unreal Engine, and it's actually pretty amazing. It's pretty good, right? This is another environment where we're trying to solve the localization problem. Can we localize where we are? And this is a little bit more challenging environment to figure out where we are. And if you're interested more in this, you should check out a poster on global pose estimation using attention-based RNNs. I think it's in the afternoon, you're going to have that. In the last 3 minutes, I just also wanted to point that memory can also be incorporated in other areas, in particular in language. Imagine that I give you some form of a text. And the question is, can I use some prior knowledge, like coreference or dependency parses or word relations, in order to come up with some representation, some better representation of the text? Just to show you a motivating example, imagine that I show you these three sentences. Mary got the football, she went to the kitchen, she left the ball there. I can build an RNN, which is what a lot of people are doing for text understanding, as Joaquin was mentioning in the previous talk. But what I can also do is I can also incorporate some coreference structure, or maybe synonyms, right? Mary and she refers to the same thing. And you can build a memory-like system that incorporates all of this structure, and basically you can embed it into the recurrent neural networks. And what it allows you to do is it allows you to solve an interesting problem, maybe just quickly to show you. Imagine that I give you these four sentences, right? And I ask you the question, how many objects is Sandra carrying? So if I just see the first sentence, Sandra went to the hallway. The question is, how many objects is Sandra carrying? State-of-the-art model gives you one. Sandra grabbed an apple there. State-of-the-art model still tells you one. And so no matter what happens, your state-of-the-art model always says one, because for the question, how many objects a person is carrying, one is a pretty good answer, because 90% of the time you're going to be correct, right? And so this is an example of where you can incorporate this additional linguistic knowledge, and it does much better. You know, it sort of says one, and it's there's a little bit of confusion, but later on says, you know, two. So there are some ways of putting the prior knowledge. And ultimately, what we'd like to do is we'd like to build intelligent agents where you have external memory, so they can remember important information in the past, and also can sort of build this knowledge-based system and incorporate some linguistic knowledge so that we can reason and communicate. And as a last part, I just wanted to show you, here's an example of trying to incorporate language and reinforcement learning jointly. So here's a setting where you're trying to train the system that says, go to the red short torch. And as the learning proceeds, the model has to figure out, what is the meaning of this command? Again, there's no linguistic knowledge in what's the meaning of the red tall or short or torch. By doing exploration, the model eventually figures out what the command is. So it's actually quite interesting. It's figuring out the meaning of the word tallest, or the meaning of the word smallest. You know, you say, go to the red skull, it figures it out. Go to the red key card, or go to the tall red object. It actually figures out the meaning of the word red and the meaning of the word tall. Or go to the largest object, right? So it figures out what the largest object is. It has to execute the instructions of looking around in the environment to figure out what is the largest object. So this is something that's called language grounding. And really, these are the kinds of systems where you have a language pipeline, you have an image pipeline, you have some fusion of both of these representations, and that representation then goes into policy, right? What action you should be taking. And so as a final note, one of the key areas that we're also trying to think about is, can we extend it to multi-agent domains, right? Multiple agents communicating through some form of a shared memory. Can we train an agent to learn to simultaneously localize and map the environment, as I alluded to before, so that we can, you know, not really rely on precise position of our agents? And finally, can we actually structure the neural maps into multi-scale hierarchy, right? So can we actually, you know, scale by incorporating longer range information and really build this multiple layers of multiple hierarchical, multi-scale, again, representation of our map. And so these are the questions that we are thinking about. On that note, thank you very much. I think I'm... I hope I did.
Perfect. We are perfectly in time, actually. Okay. I mean, you are ahead of time. So we have a time for a few questions.
Hey, thank you so much for the great talk. So my question is on the XY position of the map. You are not talking about the physical map, right? Because in the Unreal environment, whether somebody encounters the wall is a very useful signal. So you're not talking about the XY coordinates. Is that correct?
Yeah, so right now, I guess within Unreal environment, so when I talked about neural map, XY coordinates is really your physical XY coordinates. And when what happens when you hit the wall, you know, you kind of still stay within the same coordinates, right? So,
let me clarify. I'm saying that I also saw the example where you take that learning to a new environment where the wall could be in a different X and Y, but the agent still knows how to react, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So, for example, So, if you kind of like go into the new environment, the agent can still learn to react. Absolutely. And you can sort of, the way that it works is that you're training for the lots and lots of different environments with lots and lots of random mazes.
There's a question in the back.
I think it's on, yeah. There's been some work on relation networks out of DeepMind, Santoro, and so on. And in terms of characterizing a scene like you're showing here, Can you compare and contrast the advantages of a learning relations to answer some of the questions you talked about versus what you're doing?
So when you say relations, do you mean like relations, you know, what's, how do you define tallest, for example, or the shortest?
No, like if you look at a scene in 3D that's been generated, and you'll say the blue box is on top of, like Sherdlu, the blue box is on top of, but it actually helps you answer some of the questions you're looking at also.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that you can definitely incorporate some relational structure, or there's a lot of work right now trying to incorporate physics in the environment, or any sort of prior knowledge. I absolutely think that that's longer term, that's the right thing to do. For us, right now, maybe we've chosen a problem that we're now realizing might be a little bit too difficult, because we're not really giving the agent any prior information about, you know, any sort of relationship, anything that happens in the 3D environment, right? We wanted to be able to learn in an end-to-end fashion to just see, can we solve this problem? But ultimately, absolutely, you would need to incorporate some relational structure, you'd need to incorporate physics of the environment, so, you know, objects don't float in the air. And the big question is, how do you incorporate that? That's not a trivial thing to do. Because you want to be able to incorporate some prior knowledge, but at the same time, you also want to let learning adapt. And if some of your prior knowledge is wrong or is not very useful, you want, in some sense, learning to overwrite that, right? So how do you do it adaptively is, I think, an open area of research. And particularly when it comes down to language understanding as well.
A second question, do you see some of the work you're doing with, you know, I'll call it spatial memory, being useful for pose estimation for augmented reality and things like that?
For pose estimation, yes. We are thinking about how can we incorporate sort of what I've talked about, the pose estimation, global pose estimation with neural map. Absolutely. Because what we want to do is we want to be able to essentially solve SLAM in an end-to-end fashion. And I think that the spatial memory can help us a lot to achieve that. But that's work in progress, and there's a lot of different venues to pursue. I think that's actually, you know, compared to traditional SLAM algorithms, I think that these systems are much more robust, but we have to yet show it in real life.
David?
Thanks for the talk. I was wondering about the setting. So when you generalize to a new map, is the location of the indicator always at the same spot?
No, it's always changing.
I see.
So it always is changing. So the indicator changes, but it's not that far from where you start.
Okay.
So you give it a little bit of a bias to say your indicator is, you know, somewhere near where you start, but you don't put it at exactly the same location. So it can vary.
And I had a related question on the setup. So, and you always have like a single indicator on the map, right?
Yes, that's right. You only have a single indicator. So if the model basically doesn't see, and we had some examples where the model doesn't see the indicator, and it wanders around in the wrong direction and looks at the target, in many cases it actually retracts and tries to find the indicator in order to figure out what the right target to go to, because there's a 50-50% chance that you get, so expected reward is zero if you kind of ignore the indicator and just, you know, randomly hit the target.
Thank you.
Question in the back.
Hi. Here.
Hi.
Thanks for the talk. From your example in your virtual map, it seemed to me that you first started showing like easy samples with only one pipe and one color, and then you moved to more complicated examples with different pipes and different sizes and so on. So I assume that you are using some sort of curriculum learning or something like that. How important is that strategy, or you can just train showing random samples from any difficulty and it will learn, or you have to show the examples in some certain order for the...
Yeah, I think it's a very good question. So what we're observing that in 2D environments, it doesn't really matter. We can learn with enough compute. It takes a little bit of time, but we can learn. Once we move to the 3D environments, like a Doom environment that I've shown you, it becomes much harder because you have to solve the navigation problem, right? And then you have to solve this additional problem. So we found that if we actually do a little bit of curriculum learning, it helps. So initially we bias our algorithm to say the indicator is always appears, you know, at the very beginning so there is a little bit but we also tried, you know, we initially tried using curriculum learning, and then basically a lot of it depends on how much compute you have, right? So the examples that I've shown you here, we're not using any curriculum learning. But I do believe that curriculum learning would help, because it's almost like you're giving it the hints to say, this is the indicator that you see at the very beginning of your moving around. But again, I think that right now we have these systems that we can train them in a few days, and we don't need to do curriculum learning. So it learns to navigate, it learns the overall environment, and it works reasonably well.
So it appears to me the map you're using is fairly static. How do you think, like, moving things in the map, a dynamic map, will affect your spatial memory approach?
Sorry, can you repeat the question? If I move the map?
Like, if the map is fairly dynamic, there are a lot of moving objects in the map.
Good question. One of the beauties of using kind of what I've mentioned, the way that we think about, the way that we get the right operation, is we use convolutional nets. And we've tried building the environments that are a little bit dynamic. So for example, in Unreal Engine, we have some preliminary results where you train it during sort of the daytime and you switch the lights off and it's pretty dark. It actually works reasonably well. Right. So what happens, and it's not because of the algorithm, I think it's because of, you know, the convolutional nets are robust to small changes. Now, obviously, if you go to the same location, the whole thing has changed, then you're going to be confused when you're trying to self-localize. But to the environments that if I take the chair and I move it over here, that shouldn't be a problem. Again, a lot of it depends on how robust your convolutional net, and we know that they're pretty robust to small variations in lighting, in spatial orientations of objects and such. So we're hoping that we can show that they are much better than traditional SLAM algorithms like OptSLAM, which kind of like tracks features, and if you make your environment slightly different, the whole thing fails. Yeah.
All right, we'll do one last question.
I want to ask, is the required size of this type of memory, so and how the performance is affected when you increase or decrease the memory size?
So, yeah, it's a good question. So we kind of didn't really do any kind of extensive exploratory analysis on that. Right now, we're doing something very simple. We're basically saying, I'm going to just make an assumption that I'm in the maze, right, discretized locations, and that maze is of size maybe 32 by 32 or 48 by 48 or 64 by 64, which is pretty large environments. And our memory is of the same size, 64 by 64.
So actually this type of memory is implemented by, for example, by processing. It's not a real memory.
This is it's like a placeholder. You can think of it as like an array, which is mostly zero, we start with zero, and then fill in this array with the information depending on what we're seeing. But the important thing is that we're learning. We're not just storing what we're seeing. We're actually learning what to store, right? So for example, the color, the indicator color is very important to store. Something else is not very important to store. And so we're learning what information we need to store, because ultimately our goal is to say we need to store whatever we need to store such that we can solve this particular problem. Right, so it's the signal is finding the right target, and the model figures out what's the important information to store, and what's the important information to retrieve.
All right, great. Let's wrap that up.
Thank you.
Thank Russ again. Great talk.
Thanks.